Hi everybody, today is May 21st, 2013. I had touched on the subject before about North Korean defectors going to South Korea and getting South Korean citizenship and then coming to the United States. My concern was sleeper cells. Here's an article that says, in South Korea, high-profile defector is accused of spying for the North by his sister. Earlier this year, one of the most prominent North Korean defectors, Yoo Sung, walked out of his apartment building here and found four South Korean government vehicles waiting for him. Authorities hauled Yoo away and arrested him on charges of espionage. They had learned of his alleged crime, court documents show, thanks to testimony from his sister, who said Yoo had been sent on a mission by North Korean secret police to infiltrate the defector community and pass back information about the people he met. Yoo, 32, is being held at a detention center on the outskirts of Seoul, his case a reminder of how this peninsula's messy and sometimes covert conflict has left the South on edge, with people here unsure who they can trust. Defectors from the North are increasingly facing the brunt of the suspicion. As more flee to the South, some 25,000 in total, nearly all coming in the past two decades. South Korean analysis and government officials say the North has expanded a program used to sow anxiety and collect information, both by disguising spies as defectors and by pressuring defectors to become spies after they arrive. The South, in turn, has raised its guard about those entering the country, changing its protocol 3 years ago to allow for lengthier interrogations of arrivals from the North. Yoo's trial, which began May 9th and could continue for weeks, weighs two conflicting scenarios. In the first, arranged by prosecutors, Yoo was threatened by the North into serving as a spy. In the other, put forward by the defense, Yoo is an innocent defector whose sister, after attempting her own defection to the South in October, was coerced into a wrongful confession by intelligence agents who interrogated her for more than 2 months, and then held her in near isolation for several months more. The account of Yoo's case, based on an extensive review of legal documents as well as interviews with Yoo, his attorney, his sister, and former colleagues, acquaintances, and roommates, casts new light on the way defectors are treated when they arrive in the South and after they settle. A brief statement about the interrogation tactics was provided by South Korea's National Intelligence Service, NIS, which led the investigation of Yoo's sister. South Korean prosecutors, by custom, do not speak with the media before a trial and declined several requests. In the past 5 years, South Korea has arrested 14 defectors accused of being spies, something previously unheard of. And Yoo is perhaps the highest profile among them. Before his arrest, Yoo was working at City Hall as the first defector to become a Seoul city servant. And he occasionally visited elementary and high school, speaking about his frustration with the North's government and expressing hope for Korean unification. Soon after Yoo's arrest on January 10th, the South said it would strengthen background checks for defectors who apply for public sector jobs. Yoo maintains his innocence and said in a recent interview at the Seoul Detention Center that he feels totally helpless. Sitting behind a clear plastic pane that divides the room where he can meet with outsiders for 10 minutes daily, he wore an olive jumpsuit bearing his prisoner number, 50. Yoo spoke in a rush, occasionally using fragmented English. "I do not know why my sister has done this," he said. Those who know Yoo in South Korea say that if he is a spy, he hid it extremely well. He stood out for only one reason, compared with many defectors bewildered by the capitalist and high-pressure South. Yoo, who arrived in 2004, adjusted unusually well to the free world. He earned a degree from Seoul's top university and packed his day with social activities, speaking engagement, dinner parties, weddings, weekly meetings with four or five defector groups. Yoo was hired at City Hall in 2011, and the job suited him well. Friends and colleagues say he assisted those in need of Seoul's welfare programs, including many defectors. One day, a network television camera followed him on the job as he visited an elderly defector confused by tax documents. Defectors trust me more because I understand them better, you said as the cameras rolled. But you was different from most defectors, and he defected successfully to South Korea only because he kept a secret when he first arrived. Yu's attorney now admit he had indeed been born in North Korea, but he was a Chinese citizen, meaning he carried a Chinese passport and could enter and exit the North with freedom. Inconceivable to the average North Korean. That Yu held a Chinese passport was an important detail, because Chinese, even those born in the North, are not entitled to automatic South Korean citizenship, as are typical defectors. Yu's attorneys say Yu lied to interrogators about his identity when he arrived, and he received years of aid earmarked for defectors, to which he was not entitled. There are some 4,000 Chinese in the North living in pockets in Pyongyang, or, as Yu's family did, along the northwestern border. His father was a city worker and his mother a nurse. Both were born in China. When they ran low on food, Yu was able to cross into China and earn money by selling deer meat, mushrooms, and North Korean-made pottery. Still, after Yu arrived in the South, he gave friends here the impression his family was no different than others in North Korea, something that had become a point of bitterness and suspicion for other defectors. He spoke about his family, as many defectors do, sparingly but with concern. He did occasionally express hope about reuniting with his only sister, younger by 7 years. But Yu never mentioned that she had moved from North Korea, where she too had been born and raised, to China in 2011. Yu, like some high-profile defectors, also kept in touch with a member of South Korea's NIS, who served as a de facto minder. When his sister, Yu Gae Ryo, set out for South Korea on October 30th, Yu sent a hopeful text message to the NIS agent. Yu did not mention that his sister's defection would require the same deception he had used. "She's my only sister," Yu told the agent in a message shared by Yu's attorney. "Please look out for her." "Everything will work out," the agent replied. As with any new defector, Yu's sister's first stop in South Korea was the Joint Interrogation Center. And this is outside of Seoul. The facility, activists say, is a legal gray zone where defectors are given no guidance from lawyers, allowed little sleep, interrogated at odd hours of the night, and sometimes kept in solitary for weeks at a time. It is here that South Korean intelligence officials try to weed out spies. The 14 defectors arrested over the past 5 years compare with zero in the 5 years prior, according to South Korean officials. They include would-be assassins as well as attempters who tried to extract secrets from military officers. Among those defectors charged with espionage, at least one has been acquitted. Fueled by concerns about the arrest, South Korea enacted a law in 2010 that allowed new arrivals to be held and interrogated for up to 180 days. Previously, interrogations had been capped at 90 days. For Yu's sister, the tone of interrogation intensified after agents realized she was a Chinese citizen, she later said. According to documents from prosecutors, Yu's sister was then asked about her brother. It is unclear whether those agents had previous reason to suspect him of wrongdoing, but the NIS said in a statement that the subsequent investigation of Yu Woo-sung originated from what Yu's sister said next. It was a story she would retract. She said her brother had initially settled in the South with no intention of working on behalf of the North, but that changed when he took a risky trip back to the North in 2006. Bribing his way across the Chinese-North Korean border to attend their mother's funeral, she said. Days after the funeral, she said her brother was dragged away by North Korean secret police for 7 days of investigation. After that, she said, Woo walked with a limp from the beatings he had received. He had also been given a stark choice. He could return to the South, burrowing into the defector community, and report back about those whom North Korea describes as human scum, or his family would be imprisoned. His sister told agents that Yu agreed to work for the secret police, and she said she was complicit in his plot. Yu returned to South Korea, where he met hundreds of defectors, recording their names and contact information, Yu's sisters told her interrogators. He then sent files on some 200 people to North Korea with her help, she said. She would cross from North Korea into China, download the data at the internet cafe near the border, and then carry the information back to the North. Yu's sister also testified that her brother, between 2007 and 2012, took several secret trips to North Korea to meet with the Boabu. After Yu's sister told all this to the South Korean intelligence agents, prosecutors decided that her testimony should be part of the official record. So on March 4th, Yu's sister was taken to a district court where prosecutors asked her more than 140 questions. According to the court transcript, where she restated the case against her brother, who was also in the courtroom. "You and your brother work for the Boabu?" she was asked. "Yes," she said, sobbing. "You're afraid of some kind of revenge from them, so that's why you decided to work for them?" "Yes." But last month, Yu's sister changed her tone, a shift that came after she encountered her brother in a courtroom for a second time. Their meeting came during an April 26 hearing at which the judge would rule whether Yu's sister was being illegally detained at the Joint Interrogation Center. At that point, she had spent 178 days with the intelligence agents. It was springtime, but Yu's sister arrived in court wearing a heavy green hooded jacket, her skin pasty, her eyes red, her hair in a bun. Her brother walked in minutes later. He had come to help petition for her release. He was handcuffed and bound by blue rope around the waist. Guards removed the rope and handcuffs, and Yu sat one row in front of his sister. He looked back at her once, tentatively. She began to sob. He looked back again seconds later, and his voice squeaked, "Don't worry, I will save you." He reached out his hands toward her, and she rose from her chair, lunging for it, and fell to the floor, her body heaving with sobs. An hour later, a judge ruled that Yu's sister was free to leave the interrogation center, but that she would have to be deported to China by May 23rd. She spent the next morning with Yu's attorneys, who called a small news conference at their office in the Seoul neighborhood. There, Yu said that everything she had told the agents about her brother was false. Her brother was not a spy, she said, and that they had never worked with the Boyu. She said her original story was simply a way to make agents stop mistreating her. Those six agents had kicked her and hit her in the head, she said. They also misled her, she said, making her believe Yu had confessed to spying. The agents told her that she would be rewarded and that her brother would be given leniency if she cooperated and confirmed their suspicions. Those agents then drafted a confession for Yu's sister, one filled with details that laid out Yu's double life. "I copied the confession with my own handwriting and signed it," Yu's sister said. "I am really sorry for what I've done to my brother," she added. "I made him suffer." South Korean authorities say Yu's sister's news conference retraction will not change their case against her brother. Her initial testimony, she said, is part of the official legal record, and they said they believe is true. Her change of testimony was coerced by the lawyers, one official at the prosecutor's office said in a brief conversation before declining an interview. The intelligence service in its statement said it uncovered additional evidence of Yu's spying after a search of his apartment and office, but it declined to specify its findings. The NIS says it has also found witnesses who spotted Yu on trips to the North. The NIS denied using violence against Yu's sister during her interrogation. But Yu's attorneys say that the additional evidence against Yu is spotty at best, and that the court should not rely on the years of old memories of witnesses. They say authorities have found no evidence on Yu's computer that he sent files or names to his sister. They say the case hinges instead on the testimony of a sibling who was easy to manipulate and rely on a skill that served her well in the authoritarian North. She will say what it takes to please authorities. When she confessed, a lot of people questioned why she would testify against her brother, said a senior lawyer representing Yu. But maybe this is a lesson because a lot of people don't know what defectors go through during interrogation. They are not briefed on their rights, and they are kept in solitude. Human nature is to get out of that process as quickly as possible. All right, bookmark my site. I'll keep you up to date. Please stay safe, and I'll talk to you later. God bless you all. Bye.